This is the official title. I've just been asked what did I want to be someone to say about what I was going to talk about, and hence, you know, why systems don't work. So, systems, they are good, and of course I would be exceptionally rude if I came to today's event and actually just dissed the whole idea of systems and organisational aspects. And, you know, there is no doubt they do work. I'm really saying yes, but. I'm not particularly a car lover, but I actually visited the guy who was my best man many years ago. I visited him, and he's got one of these, which is a McLaren sports car. And he is probably the sort of guy who is interested in that, because he's that sort of guy. But I would argue most people, whether they like McLaren sports cars, whether they could even dream of affording that, they like getting into it and driving it. But what happens under that's the boot, isn't it, it's the back, but whether it's under the bonnet or whatever, in a sense, you know, this is what they want. They want the joy of the drive, they want the joy of the comfort, they want everything else. They're not really that fussed, because they wouldn't understand it anyway. And I think it's a similar argument in terms of systems. Yes, of course you need the systems. It's almost like the engine. It makes things go smoothly and performance. But somehow or other, I think we've got to hide them. And the same sort of point that was made earlier. We've somehow got to hide them. I've been told to look at sort of horizon scanning. So there's a nice picture of a horizon. Looking at what is happening in the future.
There I am.
Hey, just to show we're up to date.
Did you see that?
So in many cases, I am going to agree with Kate with what you've said this afternoon. So, you know, it's probably, hopefully, a little bit more of a shot across the bows, maybe, in terms of some of the ways that we approach things. And what I'm going to focus on, because these are things that come out of the evidence-based research that we've done fairly recently, and they're also things that probably are more focused on my domain, which is construction. And some of you may be able to sort of realise, and I think, yeah, these are important for you as well, and some slightly less so, but we'll see how we get on through those. You might be aware of Pavlov, and of course, very famous sort of idea, isn't it? You know, you put the food there, and this is a different take on Pavlov. You know, watch what I can make Pavlov do. As soon as I drool, he'll smile and write in his little book. So it sort of rather puts the things on the other feet, as it were. And of course, we're not talking about dogs; we're talking about workers. So how do we get those pesky workers to do what we tell them to do? Okay. Well, that's a good question, because most of the time they don't, or it seems as though they don't. I just want to explore that for a little while. And this idea of managing workarounds. We did some research funded by IOSH, the Institution of Occupational Safety and Health, and we looked at logistics, healthcare and construction, and we looked at how knowledge flow, OSH, Occupational Safety and Health, OSH knowledge flow went around large organisations. And then we did some follow-up work where we did the same thing, but looking at micros and SMEs. And okay, well, you know, how does this happen? How does what you plan not end up with what actually happens, and what goes around as that happens? I'm concentrating on construction a little bit today, but we are going to touch on some of the others as well. And IOSH have produced quite a lot of reports, as you might be aware. Some of you might be members. We were involved in two of those reports, and they produced a book about health and safety in a changing world. So if it's something that interests you, you might want to look that up from IOSH. I do not get royalties for the book, sadly. So one of the first things I want to look at is, how do people turn information, which might come out of a system, into knowledge, into something that would actually change the way that they do what they do, okay? And I want to start off looking at the personal aspects. Now, I am not a psychologist. I'm not a peacockologist either, as it happens. But we call this the peacock model, person-centric OSH knowledge flow model, okay? Just because we gave it a name and people like names. It's not rocket science, okay? So some of you, if you've got psychologists in the room, you're going to say, actually, Alistair, that isn't how things happen. I accept that. But we've developed a little sort of model, really, which we find helpful in trying to explain to people in simple words what might be happening, what might be going on in this sort of area. So we have a person, it's person-centric. And that person, then things are happening. around that person, either external to the person or in some of them internal to the person. Okay? So we start off, for instance, with the source. Now, some of you might be familiar with this. You have a source and you have a channel. People in the past, Gonzola and Wagolter in particular, talked about this. And it matters who the source is because the individual will react differently depending on whether they trust the source or not. It matters what the channel is, how that information is communicated. But we're looking here at task-specific OSH input. Okay? Things that particularly relate to the health and safety of delivering that task. But as well as that happening at the top, you've also got other things. You've got a whole raft of things here, which we've called additional explicit input. In other words, the person themselves knows that these things are influencing them. There might be previous training they've been on. There might be what competitors think. There might be a whole raft of things. They might be what the newspaper have said they've read this morning. And it will change the way that they respond to what you're telling them. And as well as that explicit input, you've also got tacit or subliminal input. A person's attitude and worldview will make a massive difference. If you've ever tried to do accident analysis in a country which is predominantly a Muslim country, it's really hard. Because all you hear every single time, and I'm not wishing this in any way to be offensive, I think it's actually a very worthy approach, but it's, who am I to challenge God? God has said this will happen. So why are you asking me what might I have heard done differently? Okay? So that worldview will affect how they respond to things. And there's a load of raft of other things in here as well. The other thing that's happening then is that, that's better. This is our attempt to talk about what's happening inside the person. And I realise that we're not nice and circular like this, and we're not as simple as this at all. But something happens internally, translating that knowledge, that information into knowledge, okay, creates knowledge which will then have the potential to make a difference. But if you imagine there around this person, you've got some membranes or some filters, and we looked at two particular filters. We said there's a situational filter where the same person might do two different things depending on the situation. And there's also an individual filter where different individuals in the same situation might do different things. And that will affect how all of these things move into the person and affects their translation of the knowledge. And then you've got, this is playing up, I might go back to pushing buttons on the machine in a minute. Okay? Push it once, Alistair, that's the idea. Enactment. And that's what really matters, isn't it? What you're really interested in is behaviour. That's what you can measure. You say that person has obeyed or hasn't obeyed, has behaved well, whatever it might be. But what we often miss is that all these other things are happening around the person as well. And we shouldn't assume that that behaviour has actually occurred for the same reasons in each different person in our organisation. In this research, when we looked at enactment, the most popular type of enactment, or the most likely type of enactment, was this one, partial enactment of the message, the OSH message, because the individual considers rightly or inadvisably that the conditions and environment that they face makes the message inappropriate. That's what we found. I couldn't do that because. This was a better way of doing it. Okay? Too much hot air, but open the windows. Likely changing circumstances, workarounds, and dynamic risk assessments. Okay, so what was happening was people were saying, oh, that doesn't work, I'm going to do it this way. Okay. And hence the word workaround or shortcut. I have a bit of a problem with the word shortcut. I don't know how many safety and health people there are in the room particularly, but I would argue the reason health and safety practitioners believe that shortcuts and workarounds are always wrong and bad is because they only hear about the ones that result in accidents or incidents. Our findings and my firm belief is workarounds and shortcuts happen all the time. People never do exactly what you expect them to do, and often they're not doing it for the wrong reasons, they're not doing it for bad reasons, they're just expedient reasons. Okay? So therefore this issue of workarounds is really quite important. So the idea here is to try and think, okay, well, that enactment, it's affected by all these different things. That's the individual level. Then at the organisational level, what happens at the organisational level? The idea here of the sort of networks that we might work in. This is a typical construction project. Apologies to those that aren't construction people. Don't worry about what these are. These are individual people. So that's that little peacock model in the individual case. So each of those people is taking in something, doing something with it internally, and then doing something about it in terms of enactment. But you look at all those relationships that are there. Some of them are direct relationships, and some of them are indirect relationships. Some bounce back to the other person as well. But it's a fairly complex, but a very common picture, not just in construction, but in quite a few networked organisations. Okay. But as well as this big network, you've also got these sub-networks. And you've got this principal contractor. That's the main contractor. That's the Taylor Woodrow, the Lang O'Rourke, that type of person. The principal contractor head or regional office network is happening up at the top. You then also got the project level network, again of that big organisation, but this is project based, not head office based. You've then got the subcontractor. In construction, almost all of the work is done by subcontractors. So you've got the workers here, and then you've got the subcontractor line managers and the people that are there in the subcontractor's office and head office or regional office. Then you've got the suppliers, and a lot of things are happening to a construction site where materials are coming in, equipment, plant and equipment's coming in, and that network is affecting things as well. And then finally, you've got the site-based network, the people you see on the site and how they relate to the project manager and so forth. But what's happening in reality is all of these things are overlapping with each other. And the real challenge then is for the people who are going to get hurt, which are the people down here, what's it like for them? What sort of stress are they under? How do they make decisions? I was in a meeting the other week, and someone was saying it's a little bit like having two generals on the field of battle. How do you know which one to listen to? And then someone else said, it's not two generals, it's a general and a sergeant major. Sergeant major is the person that pays you. Okay? That's the sergeant major. Because the subcontractor probably employs the supervisor and the workers. So the project might have a fantastic safety culture, might have a fantastic system and all the rest of it. But if the guy that's actually paying you the money says, don't do it that way, do it this way, then you're stretched, aren't you? You're pressurised. You've got all those sort of things happening. And what's it like, therefore, in terms of somebody being in that position? So why don't those pesky dogs or workers do what we tell them to do? Number of things, internally to each individual, but also those organisational things as well. And in terms of horizon scanning and looking to the future, or at least looking to what's happening today, probably two of the foremost thinkers in terms of health and safety are these two gents. Now, they do make a lot of money out of their books, so if you want to make them even richer than they are already, buy their books. But they are interesting, both a little bit highbrow in a sense, but there's Sydney Decker's Safety Differently and Eric Holmnagel's Safety 1 and Safety 2. And the sort of things they're talking about, for instance, is Decker says, don't tell them what to do. This is workers. Don't tell them what to do. Ask them what they need. And again, I think you made that point there. Talk to the people. And here we've got a comment that Holmnagel makes. People are the solution, not the problem. People are the solution, not the problem. And construction's getting a little bit excited about that at the moment. There's one of the companies, Lang O'Rourke, have got this thing called Next Gear. Basically, Next Gear is stated differently, because it so happened that John Green, who used to work for Lang O'Rourke, knows Sydney Decker. They went drinking together, he got an idea, it then went and they implemented it. Most of the people in Lang O'Rourke don't realise where it's come from intellectually, but nevertheless, that's the sort of thing they're doing. People in construction are getting excited about this. The unions are saying, this is terrible. Because the idea is, or what they think the idea is safety differently is saying, don't worry about health and safety. Because we're not going to get excited about the fact that, you know, you're not sitting properly, sir, on your seat, and that's very bad, so I'm going to tell you off for not sitting properly, okay? Someone else might have, you've got a jacket on the back of your chair, I'm sorry, sir, that could be a trip hazard, yeah? And people get so uptight because everyone's, you know, getting on about these tiny little things, and safety differently is saying, look, we've got to pull back from that. Not that we can't learn from some of these things, we've got to pull back and make sure we don't lose the overall battle, as it were, because we mess around with these little things. The unions didn't like it in the first place. They didn't really understand what they were trying to achieve. But it's not actually new. This whole concept is not new. It's a lot of text on this slide. I appreciate it. But this is from 1982, from this person, Karen Sudstrom Frisk. And what she's talking about there is that people work day in and day out in a hazardous environment. Through their thoughtfulness, ingenuity, attention, and physical abilities, they compensate for poorly designed equipment, facilities, and routines, thus prevent the risks being triggered. Then one day, in a few seconds, someone loses his or her attention and the accident happens. From that moment, the human factor is recognised. And what she means by the human factor, people are blamed. It's your fault because you didn't do what we told you to do. The fact that you've been working all, you know, safely previously and adapting everything all the way through is ignored because they managed to find there's been an accident and they've picked up the fact that you haven't obeyed the rules, whatever it might be. Her argument is we don't have so many accidents because of the human factor. It's because of the human factor that we have so few. That does not mean, ladies and gentlemen, that we shouldn't have method statements and we shouldn't have systems. What I think it means is we shouldn't assume that they're going to work exactly as we expect them to work, and we should talk to the workers and find out in the real world what really happens, and therefore adjust as far as we can, be flexible, empower people to make decisions, and so forth. So that's a little bit about workaround. This idea, the third way, this is not a sort of obscure Christian cult or any other type of religious cult, don't worry. Manage the third way. There's some research that's been done over the years, Andrew Hale and David Boris in particular. They've been talking about two types of rules. One, the top-down model, where the senior people say what should happen. And the other one, the model two, the bottom-up model, where you allow workers to determine the rules. Okay? Those are two sort of opposite ends, as it were. When we were doing the work for IOSH, we then took this concept and we said, well, actually, let's look at what happens in between. Because our belief was, and the evidence we were finding, was that most things fall in between the Model 2 bottom-up and the Model 1 top-down or rule-based system. Everyone used workarounds. How do we make sure they're safe? So we're saying, in reality, how do you make sure that they're safe? So we tried to look at this, and this was a bit of a crude model, but the idea is it's a combination of both of those two. Midwives, yeah? A very funny program as it happens, but maybe in real life, a real life midwife. So, midlife crisis, that's my problem. So, okay, community midwife. Let's look first of all at a community nurse. Here's a community nurse doing a routine check, okay? A check on the patient in the community. But the home is stressful, there might even be some violence there, it's a bit of a not a very nice situation, okay? And we're going to contrast that with a community midwife, the same environment, so it's a stressed home environment, there might be some violence. But what's happening in this case is the community midwife is attending to a patient who's gone into labour, whereas the nurse is doing a routine check on the patient. And what we have here is the community midwife is at this end of the spectrum, of the continuum. In other words, what she or he does, it's more important that they are empowered and enabled to change the official rules, as it were, the strict method statement, to adapt to the situation. Because a woman in labour, lots of things are going to happen, and they might not happen the same way as they've been trained. The nurse is here, it's in the same sort of situation in terms of the environment, but the job she's doing is much more straightforward, in a sense. And therefore, it's easier just to make sure the routine goes, you know. One of the things that came out of this study, interestingly enough, were nurses who took their shoes off when they went into someone's house, which they shouldn't do. Cream carpet. You've been outside, it's pouring with rain. You want to put the person at ease. What do? Take your shoes off. That's not right. That shouldn't happen. So, you know, do you say, no, I'm going to keep my shoes on, and in you march, and there's muddy footprints everywhere, and how does that affect your relationship with the person? It's just a little example of the sorts of things that were coming out, often quite small things, but things that made quite a difference in the end. So the idea really is that we need to empower people, enable people. The workers need to understand the principles, but they need to adapt to the scenario. Nice to say, I appreciate, isn't always easy to do in reality. Another example here from the logistics sector. So we've got two different types of people, two different tasks anyway in logistics. Here we've got a warehouse worker using mechanical equipment, probably a forklift of some description, in a warehouse, and they're managing high stacks of large goods, okay, fridges or you know, washing machines, whatever. On this side, you've got a delivery driver unloading large items and delivering to an upstairs room in a residential dwelling. Okay, same sort of context in a sense. Could be the same worker in a different environment. In this situation in the warehouse, it's probably reasonable to have some rules. Also, they're using some mechanical equipment, and that's quite hazardous, and they're stacking high stacks, so that's quite hazardous. So you could expect there to be rules. Rules in terms of how fast they go, where they turn, and so forth. This one here, you might have the same sort of person. You're not using a forklift, but this person's actually got to get this bit of goods, whatever it might be, a bed or something, upstairs. And therefore, they don't know how wide the stairs are going to be. They don't know how steep the stairs are going to be. They don't know whether the carpet's going to be loose or whether it's not going to be loose. And therefore, this person needs to have the flexibility to make different choices depending on that environment. And again, you need to empower them, enable them, understand the principles and adapt to the scenario. I had a personal example, I don't know if anyone's had this. We ordered a bed, and we've been married for a certain number of years, and that's what happens. You find that the bed you got from your wedding, you know, you don't want good enough, you order another bed. And the company came and the workers came to deliver it, put it downstairs, big mattress, bed. And I said, bedroom's upstairs, man. Can't take it upstairs. Bedroom's upstairs. Health and safety. Can't take it upstairs. Now just think about that for a minute. That company, therefore, and that worker, and he was only doing what he was told, in fairness, that worker is expecting me as the customer, untrained, whether I am or not, doesn't know, he doesn't know, to actually, and maybe my wife or my kids or something else, to hunt this thing upstairs, rather than him, who could be trained and could have been enabled to do that, or two of them, however many they needed, to actually do that work for me. Myself and safety, mate. Can't do that. You know, there's something just odd going on there, isn't there? So the idea here is that sort of thing, you need that more flexibility. Here's a construction example. Not a very clear picture with the brightness here, but don't worry. There's somebody sweeping up on a scaffold, and here's somebody sweeping up at ground level. Okay. So here you have the same operation, sweeping. One of them is at ground level, and the other one is on the fourth floor on the scaffold of an office block. Okay, this is a bit of a different one, this, because in this particular situation, I'm suggesting that when we looked at this particular operation, it was more important that this person had a set of rules that he really understood. You might think, well, why is that? Why should that be compared to this person at ground level? Well, really, it's all about risk to other people and risk to themselves. So, you know, if this lock operative here didn't realise that he or she was on the fourth floor of an office block on the scaffold, then there's a falls risk, isn't there? There's also a risk of stuff coming off the scaffold falling on top of other people. The one at the bottom, you could argue they shouldn't be sweeping up anyway, they should be using a vacuum cleaner because dust is very bad, accept that. But this person on the ground level, you know, they're sweeping away, you can allow them a little bit more flexibility. Does it really matter? Do you have to be so precise in what you're asking them to do? Just making people think a little bit about that. But beware, things aren't always what they seem. In this particular case, this guy's brushing up on a pavement next to a road. And it's a road and it's a red route. If you know anything about London, that means it's a busy road and you don't block it, yeah? So actually, that person does need to understand sort of road safety and so forth, right? But the idea we're trying to suggest there is both with regards to the person, what training they've had, and to the environment, it's going to change the way that you look at these different scenarios and change the way you try to manage them in terms of your method statement. So we've got a whole host of these. If you're interested, you could look at in the IOSH work. And the idea there is just to use something like this and say, well, what scenario are we looking at? What's the competence of the person? What's the type of task they're doing? And what's the environment in which they are doing it? And let's try to empower, enable, understand principles and adapt to the scenario. So, there's the continuum. The idea here, as you move further down this end, it's more important that the person is empowered and enabled. It's more important that they really understand the principles. They understand what's behind the health and safety risk and not just the risk assessment as written down. And some scenario-based training. If you think about it, medics, particularly in an operation scenario, in a surgery scenario, they do scenario-based training. They're in there, the nurses, the anaesthetists, the doctors, everybody else, things happen. And they don't always happen in the way they should happen. And they're supposed to respond to it. And that's part of the training in medics. We probably can't afford to train people who brush up in construction projects the same as we can medics. But we need to think a little bit about the scenarios, the environments that they're in. That's a little bit about the third way and managed workarounds. So just a few take-home points, and these I think are in the handouts that you've been given for those two points from this research. Acknowledging personal complexity. People are different and they're complex and they won't necessarily do things you expect them to do. And it's not always because they're bad people. It's not always because they want to actually, you know, make more money and so forth. Sometimes, but not always. We need to empower and enable workers, and we need to develop our management systems to facilitate that. We need to understand the principles of the rules, not just the rules themselves. I believe we need to accept that workarounds exist, and therefore we need to manage them. Acknowledge organisational complexity, that if things will pass through an organisation and the message that comes out at the bottom might not be what we intended, and then train for and adapt to scenarios. Those two are fairly linked. This one probably isn't. But because I was asked to sort of horizon scan a little bit and look at what's significant and what's new and what's important, in construction, this is the big thing. Okay? We still kill people when they fall from height. No doubt about that. But actually, certainly in the big projects and the big organisations, you know, they know what they ought to do. And they're doing a reasonable job. We're killing about... when I was working in construction, which was about 26 years ago, I think we were killing about three or four times as many people as we're killing now in construction. So we're better. We're not good enough yet, but we're better in terms of accidents. But this health issue is a big issue. And far more people, a factor of 10 or more number of people are dying because of occupational health problems than safety problems. And certainly many more people are leaving industries like construction because of health problems. So managing health like safety is one of those big issues that's starting to gain interest in the construction sector. This guy's a guy called Steve Hales. He was the health and safety manager on Crossrail. He left Crossrail, which is probably when it started to go wrong. I don't know whether that's the case or not, but that he said this in 2014, and he's now on a project called Tideway. What he said was, for years we've whispered health and shouted safety. Health and safety, health and safety, health and safety, health and safety actually means safety. The majority of people who were health and safety officers were safety officers, actually. They didn't know much about health. And actually, when you add mental health to that, and we've been talking a bit about that earlier on as well, it's even more the case that the people who are managing the process just don't understand anything about it. So a real challenge, therefore, for construction. We were employed by the Institute of Civil Engineers to do some work to try and get this message over, where we did an exercise working with industry to try and work out what the costs of ill health in construction were. We focused on costs to the employer. Clearly there's costs to society in terms of hospitals and so forth, and care in later life. There's costs to the individual in terms of losing their job or not being able to earn as much money and all this sort of thing. We were focusing on cost to the employer. We presented these at an ICE event in January a couple of years ago, as it happens. And the occupational ill health in construction employer costs, excluding cancers. The reason we excluded cancers is the cost to, in cancers is not usually to the employer unless they are prosecuted. The cost is to society and the individual because the cancer happens later. Okay, but cost to employers were £848 million per annum in the UK to construction. And suddenly, the audience will go quiet and say, what? That is not an insignificant amount of money, okay, certainly from a construction perspective. And also when you look at the breakdown, musculoskeletal disorders, is the massive issue, okay? Now again, one of the reasons that that's a big issue is that musculoskeletal disorders in construction create a lot of presenteeism where people just avoid the work and don't do it or don't work so well. Not so much absenteeism, mainly because of the way that people are employed in construction, okay? But presenteeism is a major part of that, okay? Stress is also a big issue as well in terms of presenteeism and in terms of then people leaving the job because they can't cope. So in both these cases, you've got people leaving early in both stress and MSD cases, and people continuing to work but not working as well as they should do. And things like asbestos, which is a massive issue, but not really for the employers. Not now anyway, because most of them have got asbestos sorted. Still a problem, major problem, but not so much to employers, dermatitis and so forth. So MSDs and stress, but a big figure. So occupational ill health is a massive issue. And that excludes prosecutions, compensation or civil claims and associated costs. And also excludes things like loss of reputation because nobody wants to work for you or whatever. Okay, so these are just the actual costs of employment or of managing the process. So construction has put together this idea of health in construction leadership group to try and move things on, to try and change the way they do things and committing construction to a healthier future. And one of the things they did, which I think was quite helpful, they looked at this, well, okay, let's look at what health means, because most people did not understand what occupational health meant. So you've got managing the health of workers, which is probably truly occupational health. You've got promoting healthy lifestyle choices, which is really well-being. And then the third circle here is protecting people from workplace health risks. And the term is occupational hygiene. I've got a confession to make here. I've been working in research in health and safety for about 26 years and then working in industry before then. And before, probably 3 or 4 years ago, I didn't know what occupational hygiene was or what it meant. You ask an audience, What comes to mind when you talk about hygiene? Well, I go to a hygienist because I'm a group patient and I get a hygienist for free and they clean my teeth and it's rather wonderful. It hurts, but it's rather wonderful. I want to talk about, you know, hygiene or something, you know, it's something like that, isn't it? It's keeping its Dettol, it's keeping things clean, it's that sort of hygiene. I think it's a bad word, but it is the word that's the right word. Occupational hygiene, the people who protect people from workplace health risks. And all three of these things are getting sort of a bit mixed up and a bit confused. And I guess the challenge for you in your systems and the way in which you're trying to manage health and safety is, well, which of these do we go for? Do we focus on this? Do we focus on the health of workers? Do we ignore this because we don't want to be that nanny state? We don't want it's a fantastic name for beer, isn't it? Non-alcoholic beer, Brewdog, or nanny state. I think that's great, you know. But do we do a nanny state sort of thing on well-being? You know, and do we ever really look at the risks that are on the construction site? One of my pet things at the moment that I've been sort of touting about really is ban the banana. Because what happened when people first started talking about health, companies would say, well, we'll get rid of the greasy breakfast. We'll have bananas and fruit. That'll be good, won't it? That's health, that's healthy, that's good, isn't it? Well, yeah, maybe. Apart from if you've been working for 3 hours down the bottom of a hole, you know, and you really need some carbs and some, you know, some protein, then bananas aren't necessarily going to help you a lot. But it was an easy thing to do. The real challenge was that sometimes these companies were putting bananas and fruit in the canteen, but the workers were still exposed to dust and noise and all the other things, and they weren't bothered about that because that was too difficult. Okay, so occupational health is the thing that's really testing people's ability to be able to respond to things. And it's a problem too for workers as well. So I've got some goodies here as well as the sweet ones. I've got some goodies here. So here's a dermatitis hand. Okay. So this lab here is a trainee bricklayer. We developed these a few years ago. And they were supposed to be training aids for construction workers. And we were on a construction site. We went on the construction site to take some photographs. And the company gave us the... Which hand is this? This one. Okay. The company gave us some workers. The only worker they had that was directly employed was actually the forklift driver. And he was... I'm going to forget that. Don't tell anybody I've done this, though. So I'm supposed to put that on first. Not for my sake, but for yours. So, we had these things. This is dermatitis. Okay? This is what you wouldn't be working in dermatitis was this bad. We've got three gloves like this, And the gloves have a mild dermatitis and a medium dermatitis and a severe dermatitis. Sometimes if I do this talk, I actually put this on beforehand and I'm wearing a jacket and just walk around like this. And people. So, because part of the issue isn't so much systems, the things that many of you in the room are really important to you, is actually the workers themselves just don't understand, they don't get it. This young lad, he's 16 and a half, as it happens, or he was when the picture was taken. And I had this in my hand, not on my hand, but I had it in my hand. He said, "Ooh, what's that then?" "Well, it's a simulation of dermatitis." "How'd you get that then?" I said to him, "What do you do, mate?" "Oh, a bricking." He was a bricklaying apprentice, but not a bricking. "Right, do you wear gloves?" "Oh, no, I don't need to wear gloves." Now, it might be that he won't get cement-related dermatitis, because not everybody does. But just the very fact that there was this thing that looked a bit like Halloween, it was something that engaged him. And we've used these with a lot of apprentices as well, and taken some videos, and it really is amazing. The bizarre thing is, when we train people, certainly in construction, if you think about a lot of construction workers, are people where the education system has ignored them, and they've walked out of education because they weren't interested. Many of the construction workers have gone straight into construction because the education system's failed them. Most of our training of apprentices is chalk and talk. It's not even 20th century, it's 19th century. And then you put something like this in there, and they're all going like this, but at least they're talking about it. And we've got this one for dermatitis. We've got another hand I'll show you for hand-arm vibration. This is a hand, not a glove, this one. Okay. And I'll tell you another little story as well. One of my colleagues who was very much involved in developing these, we had some construction, what were they? I can't remember, I won't say the company anyway, but they were really, really sharp professionals. Two young women who had come to talk to us about research and so forth. So I persuaded my colleague to put this up her jacket. I can't believe it's that hand, but you imagine it in the jacket. So she went to shake this woman's hand. Fair dues to the woman, and they say they really were sharp cookies. She shook the hand, didn't bat an eyelid, and carried on talking. Now that takes some doing, doesn't it, really? Because she must have thought, this must be a prosthetic, this must be something else. Anyway, then Wendy took this out and went like that, which was all good fun. But, again, what we're doing, really, is we're getting people to engage with the issue, and that's a big part of the battle for the hearts and minds, as it were, of the workers. And the other side of it as well, which also causes a bit of fun, as some of you may imagine, is if you look at hand-arm vibration, we've got some gloves that don't look like hand-arm vibration, but they feel a little bit like hand-arm vibration. And again, we've got ones that are worse depending on what happens, and you tend to you get a bit clawed hand and so forth. So it does things here. It creates a discomfort in certain places, and there's some little vibrating bits in as well that when you turn it on, it goes like that. And again, you can imagine these macho lads having a good laugh at what that might be happening. So the point really is that, and it doesn't matter, the technology doesn't matter, it's engaging with the people. Okay, and again, that's the point that was made earlier on about engaging with the people, talking to the people, and making sure that they understand why you're doing what you're doing. We have also, this has moved on since then, but we also have an MSD suit, something which makes you sort of crouch down like this and makes it difficult to move around as well. So, a couple more minutes and then we've got some time, 5 minutes for questions. So in terms of intellectual output, that's something that we're talking about now. This is some work we've done on Tideway, a project in London, and that some of you might be interested. Again, the information is in the handouts. We've been looking at who does what in this developing area in terms of what does the manager, supervisor do about health, what does the OSH practitioner normally do, what does the hygienist do, what does the nurse or advisor do, and trying to help people learn a little bit about, this isn't ideal, this is what really happens, and then how they can take things on further and develop them. And one of the other things we're doing, and maybe this is a challenge for those of you that are looking at the systems you operate, is can we use some of the same things that we do for safety to start analysing health? Can we do, these are audit scores on a construction site where you go and audit the different sites on certain things to do with occupational health. and which things are correct and which things are incorrect. So you're actually looking at positive behaviours as well as the negative behaviours, and then you're sort of scoring people on that. So we're trying to move occupational health away from something which nobody understands to something which at least we can start discussing in a sensible way. So a bit on managing workarounds, a bit on, sorry, this is offending you, I just can't take it off at the moment. Managing the third way and managing health, white safety, just to give you a little bit of a flavour. But I want to finish with this slide, and again, I wasn't going to, I added this just listening earlier on. This was some work we did a number of years ago on London 2012. London 2012 had the accolade, I suppose, of not killing anybody when they built the Olympic stadiums, or well, all the stadiums, the Olympic Park. Bearing in mind, 14 people died in Beijing, 11 people died in Rio. You know, it's a reality. And it's, when you think about it, whether it's Olympics or Paralympics, it's crazy, isn't it, that we celebrate what humankind can do, and in doing that, in making the facilities, we kill people. The Olympics didn't. And one of the things we were asked to do towards the end, when that looked like that was going to be the case, we were asked to say, to find out why that was the case. What was different about the health and safety, the way it was managed on London 2012 Olympic Park? And it was called preconditioning for success. What's the preconditions that were there that made them successful? And we expected to find a lot about systems. We expected to find a lot about innovation. We expected to find a lot about training and the rest of it. These were the things we found. When we ask people, what is different about this job? People respect me. People trust me. I can trust them. I'm empowered to make some decisions. I'm motivated. People are fair. They're consistent. They're clear in the way they communicate. They're preemptive. They think about things beforehand. They don't just react at the time. But they're challenging. They don't just let people rest on their laurels. They challenge people. But they collaborate. Contractors talk to each other. They communicate the message. They're open. And they're assured there are systems in there that will actually check things and deliver on them as well. But you look at those, and that reads much more like a management textbook, a people management, a person management textbook, than it does a health and safety textbook. And really, I guess my encouragement to you is, you know, the systems work that many of you are doing is fantastic. It needs to carry on. But you need to make sure, one thing, right back at the beginning, the McLaren car, most people really don't want to know what happens to the system. They just want to get on with their job and enjoy it and enjoy life. Enjoy driving the car, maybe, in that analogy. The other thing then really is that these are the things, the bottom lines, that really make a difference. So by all means, develop your system, make them as good as you can, make them as invisible as you can, if you can do that, but really concentrate on the people, because it's the people that get hurt, and it's the people also, if you take Karen Sundstrom, her comment in 1982, it's the people that can actually get you out of trouble as well when things don't quite go to plan. Mm. That's all I have to say. We've got 5 minutes officially, unless everyone wants to run and catch a train. Thank you. I've been told nobody ever asks questions.
Yeah.
Go on.
Do you have any tricks how to get people engaged in the manual handling?
Well, you know, again, interestingly, if you can make it real, you might be interested in this. The way the suit works with us is that you get a bunch of people together. They put on these overalls that make them go like this, and they can't stand up. And then you discuss what might happen if you get a bad lower back or whatever else it might be. Now, that's just one way of doing it, but engaging people as much as possible. Certainly it works if you can, bringing people back in who are no longer working because they have had some sort of incident. That can be difficult, I know, because often when people leave your organisation, they're not always, not often leave on a good basis, as it were. But those sort of real situations, and try and almost, I would say, and again, easy to say, I appreciate it, much harder to do, but, you know, can you have a conversation with the person and say, well, you know, how can we do this? How can we improve it? What can we do for you to make your job better? Not necessarily just healthy and safe, but what can we do? We've got this stuff to do here. They might say, well, you know, get one of these trolleys, and maybe you can, you do, and then they see you've done it. So if you can engage in that rather than, you know, seeing somebody lifting something badly and just coming down like a ton of bricks. But getting people to realise that it will make a difference is difficult. because it doesn't make a difference straight away. In most cases, it just happens many years later. I'm a 60-year-old with a bad back, so I don't know what that means. But I'm happy to have a chat after.